Please.
Okay. This is the case of a 48-year-old male who is a coolie and hails from Jayanagar, Bangalore. He has studied up to 10th standard and belongs to the upper lower class according to the modified Kuppuswamy classification. The informant is his wife, who is reliable. He is right-handed. He was admitted on the 28th of August 2021 and he was examined on the 31st of August 2021. He came with the chief complaints of weakness of right upper limb since 6 days, weakness of right lower limb since 5 days, inability to speak since 3 days, and deviation of angle of mouth to left side since 3 days.
Yeah, Mahima, just a minute. Here, the first two slides are important for us, okay? So, yes. You know, as a basic clinician, not necessarily a neurologist, when you see a patient who has acute onset of neurological symptoms, you have written very nicely that he has a right-handed individual, okay? So, handedness is extremely important for us, okay? Why? Can you tell a few words regarding handedness?
Yes, sir.
If possible,
It tells you which lobe of the cerebral hemisphere is dominant in an individual.
Exactly,
so right-handed lobe, right-handed people, the 99% of the time, it's the left lobe that is dominant.
Excellent. So we have cerebral dominance of right side, cerebral dominance of left side, as well as we have co-dominance. Okay. So it is important for two reasons. One is to interpret the clinical signs. Second thing is to interpret the amount of severity of the disease. Third thing, to prognosticate the recovery. Okay. So this is very important for us. You know, we have a lot of studies which has compared right-handed stroke versus left-handed strokes and assess the prognosis and recovery of different types of patients. Okay, that is one thing. Second thing is, how did you tell he is right-handed? Can you tell me, how can you tell if a patient is right-handed or left-handed?
Yes, sir.
Do you have any idea? If you don't have an idea, I can prompt.
Yes, sir. One is, you can ask him to write. If that is not possible, you ask him to look through a pinhole, and the eye that he uses is generally the dominant eye. You can ask him to cut or hold a spoon or kick a ball. All those things.
Excellent.
Dominant side.
Yeah, you have done everything correctly except for writing, because, you know, right-handed, what happens because of our customary, our cultures and other things, the mothers tend to force the kids to write in the right hand. So the handedness is not equal to writing, okay? Except that kicking the ball is fine, throwing a ball is fine, seeing through a microscope is fine, as well as, you know, other things what you describe is fine, except for the writing, okay? Because we call it a shifted synestheles. Sometimes what happens because of the force by the parents, child may force to write on the right hand despite actually being a left-hander. Okay, so only handedness, when you somebody asks you, don't mention the writing part of it. Okay, this is very important. Okay, these are the few things I want to tell you. Okay, one more thing is occupation. Okay, so certain diseases have propensity to develop in certain occupations. Okay, so can you tell me stroke and any occupation? Can you relate something? If at all there is a nicotine exposure.
Nicotine exposure.
If there's a tobacco exposure, if some toxins, okay, something like, you know, cocaine or nicotine. So certain occupations, whenever you present a case, you know, you should have a broad idea where each disease what you are talking and what are the occupations you are dealing with. Okay, if an examiner asks you, you can maybe able to tell in a better fashion. Okay, so these are the basic things you should always mention when you think about a basic personal details of the patient. Okay, one more thing is age. We'll come to the age on the later part. Okay, let us go to the chief complaints. So you have weakness of right upper limb since 6 days, weakness of right lower limb since 5 days, inability to speak since 3 days, and deviation of angle of mouth to 3 days. Okay, so we have an acute history of acute neurological illness. Okay, in neurology, anything acute is either vascular or traumatic. Okay, that is a dictum for us. Okay, so either it is a vascular phenomena or it is a traumatic phenomena. Vascular could be an arterial phenomena or it could be a venous phenomena. Okay, but can you tell me one peculiarity in this chief complaint? It is basically a stepwise pattern. Okay, you have a 6 days of lower upper limb, then comes, can you hear me? Yeah, 6 days of upper limb, then 5 days of lower limb, and inability to speak since 3 days, and deviation of angle of mouth since 3 days. So we have a stepwise pattern here. Okay, is that important, Mahima?
Yes, sir, it's showing progression.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, so some of the strokes are all will happen together. In some strokes, things happen in a stepwise pattern. Okay, so this is very important for us. The moment somebody tells his history, actually we would have made a diagnosis. Okay, why? How can it make a difference for us?
Sir, in cases of thrombotic stroke, there is a gradual progression of symptoms. But
excellent.
In embolic or hemorrhagic, the maximum weakness is at the onset.
Beautiful. Excellent. So it is called stroke in evolution. Okay. So it can evolve over time. Okay. That is very important thing. So the moment somebody tells this history, we know the which side, right or left side, most likely. And we also know what kind of stroke it is, even before going exactly into the history, details of history or examination. Okay. So this is our pattern. So at each symptom level, let us say I have seen the patient at today or tomorrow or third day or fourth day. So each level, my diagnosis keeps changing. Let us say I have seen the patient on the day, you told us in 6 days. So if I had seen that patient on that day, I would have had a weakness of only right lower limb. What would have been my diagnosis? I would have a localized disease into the probably left hemisphere. If it is central cause, I'm talking about. Anyway, there are a lot of peripheral causes as well. Probably in the leg area. Okay. Then had, sorry, the hand area. Then hand the, then came the leg area. Then came the speech part of it. Then came the deviation part of it. Okay. So each level, our localization changes. Our lateralization may change as well as our etiology may change. Okay. So always when you take a history, always give extreme importance for the pattern. Okay, we want to talk about the pattern of involvement. Okay, at that level, so some examiners have a habit of stopping at each level. Why I am trying to stop at each level is not to embarrass you. My point of view here is we have to be trained ourselves at each level what DDs we can give. Okay, so here upper limb, you should think of what is area, lower limb, what is the think of area, and speech, what is the area, as well as deviation of angle of mouth, what is the area. So that will come to the later part. Okay, so we have a chief component of acute neurological illness involving upper limb followed by lower limb followed by speech followed by deviation of angle of mouth. Okay, sure, good, proceed.
So patient was apparently normal 6 days ago when he developed acute onset weakness of right upper limb. Patient noticed it at around 8 p.m. and he had difficulty in using his hand to eat. The weakness progressed over the next 3 days where the patient had difficulty in combing hair, lifting his arm over his head to reach objects and difficulty in holding a glass of water and was unable to use his right hand to button his shirt. Acute onset weakness progressed to right.
Yeah, one minute. Just a minute, my ma'am. Each level will dissect it out, okay? Can you just analyze what is there in the first paragraph?
Yes,
so
sir.
You told there is sudden onset of neurological illness characterized by difficulty in using the hand. Okay. Yeah. What exactly happened? Can you a little bit analyze that?
It means he's having distal muscle weakness.
Excellent. Okay. Then what happened?
Then it gradually progressed to proximal because he was not able to abduct his hand over his head.
Okay. So what does it tell to us? If the weakness has progressed from the distal to proximal. Okay. What does it tell to us?
It's more of a UMN lesion.
Yeah, UMN. See, it can happen in both conditions, but considering acuteness, you think of a UMN lesion. Okay, so probably the movements are paralyzed here. Movements are affected. Okay, we know the difference, right? Muscle paralysis versus movement paralysis. So movements are more affected in the case of UMN lesion, whereas muscles are more affected in the case of LMN lesion. Okay, so this is what makes a patient disabled. So see, whenever we analyze a case, we should think about his disabilities, day-to-day activity. Neurologist, everything about day-to-day activities. He is unable to carry out what he used to do earlier. That is what is bothering him. Okay. And so we should have a lot of importance for individual activities. Okay. So, you know, difficulty in buttoning a shirt and unbuttoning a shirt is a very embarrassing thing for the patient. It is very, you know, disabling thing for the patient. So here the movements are gone, probably the fine coordinated movements of the right hand, that to the dominant hand is affected. Okay. That too of acute onset. That is why we think of an acute vascular etiology involving the hand area to begin with and gradually extending into the other areas. Okay. Good. Excellent. Go ahead.
Acute onset weakness progressed next day, which was 5 days ago. Initially had difficulty in gripping his slippers, which progressed. He then had difficulty in climbing stairs and getting up from a squatting position. Patient, however, was able to continue to walk without support, although with difficulty.
Yeah. Can you briefly analyze that?
Yes, sir. Again, he is initially complaining of distal weakness, which then progressed to proximal. But although it's a paresis, it's not a plegia. So he was able to continue to walk.
Okay. So you are telling the upper limb weakness was much more severe and it was much initial, followed by a lower limb weakness, which was comparatively less severe. Okay. Yeah. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. 3 days ago, patient woke up at 8 a.m. and had lost the ability to speak. He was able to comprehend speech and for commands, but was at work. He has also noticed deviation of mouth to left side, which was the saliva,
Yeah. So here patient has got lost his ability to speak. Okay. So what do you call it as?
Aphasia.
Aphasia. Okay. So can you briefly tell what is aphasia and what is dysarthria, if you don't mind?
Yes, aphasia is more of a function of the cortex, and okay. It includes language. So including reading and writing will be affected. Whereas dysarthria affects the muscles of articulation.
Excellent. Good. So disturbance of, it's a very broad umbrella. Okay. Aphasia is a broad umbrella which encompasses a lot of things. Okay. So that basically disturbance of expressing oneself. Okay. Disturbance of language is aphasia. Okay. So here patient has got a right-sided weakness of the hand, followed by the proximal, followed by the lower limb, as well as inability to speak. So we are probably dealing with the combination of a motor weakness plus a disturbance in language. Excellent. Okay. So deviation of angle of mouth refers to probably right-sided facial weakness, and that has caused him to deviate to the left side. Okay. Can you get a difficulty in closing eyes? Here you have clearly mentioned patient was able to close eyes, right? So can a UMN lesion can produce a condition where patient will not be able to close eyes? Is it possible? If you can not tell, I will tell you.
LMN lesion of the facial nerve will cause
LMN is correct. See, what happens sometimes
is the lesion to the brain.
Excellent. Yeah, what happens is even in acute UMN lesions, sometimes you know that the bilateral representation of upper face, right? So sometimes it may take some time for the eye closure, you know, to happen. Okay, sometimes in acute UMN facial palsies, there may not be good eye closure. Okay, there may be transient weakness of eye closure which gradually recovers over time. Okay, so don't get carried away by the fact that even in a UMN lesion of a cortical or a subcortical etiology, still you can have difficulty in closing eyes for a transient period of time. Okay, and that can gradually will be overcome. Good, go ahead.
Patient was recently diagnosed with hypertension and diabetes mellitus. There is no history of trauma or fever. There is no history of headache or vomiting, no history of loss of consciousness or seizures, no history of decreased sensation, no history of decreased smell, blurring of vision, double vision, decreased sensation over face, decreased hearing or vertigo, difficulty in swallowing, nasal regurgitation or nasal regurgitation on swallowing, and no hoarseness of voice, which indicates cranial nerve involvement, no history of tremors, no history of chest pain or palpitations.
Yeah, just a minute. Can you go to the previous slide? Yeah. See here, what is important is this recently diagnosed hypertension and diabetes. He is just a 48-year-old male, right? So probably his duration of vascular risk factors is not long-standing. Okay. So what is important here, the fact is history of the vascular risk factors, I mean the hypertension and diabetes, is not long-standing for him. So the fact is there may be other causes of stroke. See, what is our common tendency is the moment stroke comes, it is attributed to diabetes, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, end of the story. Okay. But that shouldn't be the end of the story. Even in hypertensives, even in diabetics, there may be other causes of stroke. Okay. That to the, if the stroke and if the hypertension and diabetes of shorter duration, all the more reason to search for other causes of stroke. Okay. So the duration of illness is very important for us. That is important. Okay. Second thing, can you tell me why did you ask for history of fever and trauma here? Did it make any difference for us?
So trauma also can produce acute onset neurological deficit. And fever, I thought because of something like tuberculosis, which can cause vasculitis and tubercular meningitis causing vasculitis. And then
that is a very good answer. Yeah. Apart from that, anything else? Fever and stroke, if there is no infection. Stroke alone can produce fever. Remember this, okay? Yeah, exactly. Okay, so stroke alone can produce fever. Okay, yeah. Fever may be as a part of, it could be a cause of stroke or an effect of stroke. So fever could be both, okay? So fever per se, especially the central fevers in case of certain strokes, you may not be able to treat that fever at all. It will be very high grade fever and does not respond to your antipyretics, okay? So trauma, it can produce EDH, it can produce SDH, it can produce SCH, lot of things, contusions, diffuse axonal injuries, all of them, these things can mimic like stroke. So they probably come under the different causes of stroke secondary due to the trauma. Fever, you are right. Certain infections can produce meningitis, meningoencephalitis can produce, viral encephalitis can produce, tuberculosis can produce, fungal meningitis and meningoencephalitis can produce. All of them can present with the acute neurological deficits mimicking stroke. Okay. So these are the important causes of infective etiologies of stroke. Stroke is not necessarily due to thrombosis. It may be secondary to infections as well. Excellent. Headache and vomiting, does it make a sense?
Increased intracranial tension can cause headache and vomiting. Okay. So it's basically ruling out hemorrhagic stroke.
One more thing is, see, in large ischemic stroke, you can have raised ICT. In a large ischemic stroke, you can have a raised ICT. In cerebral venous thrombosis, CVTs, you can have raised ICT, okay? And obviously, in case of hemorrhagic strokes, you can have a raised ICT. So that should prompt a clinician regarding the management, okay? So are we dealing with the patient who has got raised ICT? Should we go aggressive with the anti-edema measures? Okay, that is the importance. So every piece of information, every bit of sentence what you utter in exam, if you really think, makes a difference in the patient management, okay? So because at the end of the day, our job is to treat the patient, okay? Presenting case is just a part of academics, but at the end of the day, you're a clinician. That is why all these, every bit of history is important for us. Generally, we don't think about this. We routinely, mechanically ask, no history of headache, committing no history of fever, no history of trauma. But what is the idea behind it is this, okay? So it makes a difference for our treatment, okay? See, vomiting, as you know very well, may be a sign of raised ICT, may be a sign of our Cushing's reflex, okay? Bradycardia, systolic hypertension, regular respiration. So patient may be landing up with the reflex, okay? That is why vomiting becomes important. Body tries to push the water as much as possible out of the body, at least to reduce the intracranial pressure to a certain extent that the stroke pathology will be taken care of. It is the body's natural compensatory mechanism, okay? That is what we should be thinking about, okay? Yeah. LOC? Loss of consciousness. Can you hear me? Emma, hello?
Hello, sir.
Sorry, there was some interruption. Yeah. I think. Yeah, go on.
Yes, sir. One second. So, can you see the slides?
Yeah, good. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. No history of loss of consciousness or seizures.
Okay.
No history of decreased sensation, no history of decreased smell, no history of cranial nerve involvement that includes decreased smell, blurring of vision, double vision, decreased sensation over face, decreased hearing or vertigo, difficulty in swallowing or nasal regurgitation on swallowing, and no hoarseness of voice, no history of tremors, no history of chest pain or palpitations.
Yeah, 1 minute. So here, why is loss of consciousness important for us?
Sir, there are certain conditions where it can mimic stroke. Things like seizures, like Todd's paresis, can mimic stroke. Loss of consciousness and seizures go hand in hand, general chronic-tonic seizures. Then other conditions like metabolic encephalopathy, like hypoglycemia or hyperglycemia, can also mimic stroke. Migraines, things like that.
Yeah, there are two things. One is LOC as a part of the stroke. Second thing is the stroke mucus we are talking about. Okay. So loss of consciousness can indicate a large stroke in the hemisphere or even a small stroke in the brain, which disturbs the reticular activating system. Okay. Even in the critical areas of the brain, if there's even a small stroke, for example, in a brain stem, then patient can have loss of consciousness. But same thing to happen in the hemispheric region, it has to be a very large stroke because a lot of fibers have to be involved to cause loss of consciousness. Okay. So either we are dealing with the if there is a loss of consciousness, either we are dealing with a brainstem stroke or a hemispheric stroke, probably large in case if it's a hemispheric stroke, or if it is a small in case of a brainstem stroke, okay? Or it can be a large as well. So even a small stroke is enough in the brainstem to produce altered sensorium, okay, or loss of consciousness. So it probably tells us about the severity of the disease, okay? So our NIH score becomes poor. Our line of management also can may change if there is a loss of consciousness, okay? Because we should be more vigilant, and patient may need in the future decompressive craniotomy if it's a very large stroke and with the altered sensorium. That is one thing. Seizures, at least two or three possibilities are there. One is an embolic stroke. Stroke can present with seizures. Second thing is venous thrombosis can have seizures. Third thing is a bleed. Bleed can also have seizures, okay? Even in a case of ischemic stroke, if it is a cortical in origin, if not subcortical, subcortical strokes generally do not have seizures, whereas a cortical strokes can have seizures because seizures is basically a disease of the gray matter, okay? So these are the things we should be remembering whenever you talk about loss of consciousness or seizures, okay? Regarding decreased sensation, here one thing is important here. If patient has got aphasia, please be careful when you tell loss of sensation, okay? Patient will not be able to tell the sensations are there or not there, right? So whenever you write a history, so be careful. If patient is having aphasia, you may not be able to examine the sensory system, okay? So if patient has got a global aphasia, definitely not. If at least he has got a Broca's aphasia, he may be able to understand, but he may not be able to, you know, express, okay? So this, you should be very, very careful. Whenever you write loss of sensation or inability to perceive sensations, make sure that patient is able to talk, is able to comprehend. Otherwise, you shouldn't write about, you can tell, I cannot comment on the sensory historically, okay? Regarding cranial nerves, yes, they are important. There are two, three possibilities. If it is a multifocal stroke involving multiple areas, it can be anterior circulation, posterior circulation, brain stem, then you may have multiple levels of lesions or multiple symptoms pertaining to cranial nerve lesion. One important point I would like to give here, even in the case of a cortical stroke, sometimes you can have some of the brainstem signs or a brainstem symptom, okay? So you may have a dysphagia, you may have a difficulty in breathing, you may have difficulty in talking, or you may have difficulty in swallowing, even in the case of, although not common, even in the case of a unilateral hemispheric strokes, that depends on the percentage of nerve fibers, okay? As you know, there are right and left hemispheres and different fibers come from both sides, and finally they go and supply the respective muscles or the neuromuscular apparatus, okay? So what we should remember here is it depends on the percentage of distribution. Some people right may be having more fibers, some people left hemisphere may be having more fibers. In that case, even in the unilateral hemispheric lesion, you can have apparent or pseudo LMN signs in a UMN disease. Okay. So this is a very important thing. It is not a common thing, but if you have a difficult case, for example, you have one patient of one cranial nerve palsy, except everything else is fitting into the cortical lesion, then you can use this as an explanation to the examiner to defend yourself, telling that there may be an element in a UMN disease. Okay, that is important. Understood, no? And one more thing is why we are asking about dysphagias, difficulty in breathing, dysarthrias, diplopias, all these things is whenever the D's come in stroke, all D's should warn us. Okay, because this stroke is not a simple stroke. This is going to be a complicated stroke, and we have to be very careful because they are likely to aspirate. Okay, If you would have seen in our wards, patients are on a RILS tube. So most likely stroke with a RILS tube is a lateral medullary syndrome or a brainstem stroke. Okay. So whenever you have a stroke with difficulty in swallowing, difficulty in breathing, or difficulty in talking, or difficulty in swallowing, all the more important to give more emphasis on them, because they are likely to aspirate, they are likely to develop respiratory difficulties. Okay. Stroke per se, in a case of brainstem involvement, may have something called Ondine's curse, where they may have they may actually forget to breathe. Their breathing may become irregular. They may develop brainstem pattern of breathing, and patient can worsen. Okay. So the every point we write in the history is basically, one is to make a diagnosis, second thing is to prognosticate. How severe is my patient of stroke? Should I give more emphasis on this particular patient? Should he be in ICU or should he be in ward? So every detail what you write is basically based on these things. Okay, this we should import, this should understand, because generally we become a mechanical clerks when you write a case history. So you keep on writing all the negatives without knowing the positives behind the negatives. Okay, so positives behind these negatives is to make us understand what is the severity of the each disease and where to triage this patient. Is it red? Is it orange? Is it green? Is it blue? What is the triage the patient actually wants? Okay, that is what is important. Okay, so tremors, is it make a difference? Does it make a difference in this case? Did you ask with any particular intention?
Cerebellar involvement.
Cerebral involvement is fine. Other than that, suppose patient has got thyroid illness. Okay, thyroid illness can also cause stroke. So that could be one possibility. Okay, or involvement of our something called Guillain-Mollet triangle. It may be too much for you. In the brainstem, if there is a triangle which generates tremors, we call it as tremorogenesis. Okay, we have central oscillators in the brain. We have peripheral oscillators. So tremors probably indicate the structure where it is getting involved. Or there may be an antecedent, or there may be a cause of the tremor, which could be the same cause for the stroke as well. For example, some patient on sympathomimetic drugs, adrenergic drugs, okay, they are basically vasospasm, they cause vasospasm. For example, cocaine. So all these things can also cause tremors. They can also cause vasospasm. So vasospasm could be the cause of stroke. Okay, so my point here is, whenever you write a history, negative history, you should be able to tell to the examiner why I have written, okay, and what is the idea behind writing this particular history. Okay, chest pain and palpitation, does it make sense? Why did you write it?
Sometimes the cause of stroke could be a cardioembolic lesion.
Excellent. Very good. Very good. So see, two things are important. Whenever you think of a stroke, especially a thrombotic or an embolic stroke, is it from artery to artery or is it from heart to artery, especially for an embolic stroke? Okay. So atrial fibrillation and stroke are very important deadly combinations. Okay. Around 15 to 20% of strokes will have atrial fibrillation. If you analyze 100 patients, up to 30%, max, around mean is around 15% may have atrial fibrillation. Okay. So what is the importance of this is, we have to anticoagulate those patients probably for a very long period of time. And unless you do anticoagulation for those patients, patient can likely to have recurrence of stroke. Okay. See, your aim is not just to treat the patient, also to prevent the recurrences of stroke. That is why we always ask for history of cardiac illness. It may be, paradoxical embolus, it may be atrial septal defect, ventricular septal defect, tetralogy of Fallot. So many things can happen. Infective endocarditis, there's a clot in the left atrium. So many things can actually cause stroke. Okay. So that is the importance of asking any cardiogenic symptoms in a case of a neurogenic history. Okay. Because the artery of the heart as well as the artery of the brain, they are from the same human being. They are not from the different human being. So the pathogenesis of same, both, they are shared. Okay. That is why you always should address another organ when the primary organ is being affected. Okay. Excellent. Good. Go ahead.
Past history, he was diagnosed with hypertension and diabetes 1 month ago. He's currently on amlodipine and metformin. There is no history of similar complaints in the past. There is no history of transient loss of consciousness or transient blurring of vision or loss of vision in the past, and no history of epilepsy, tuberculosis, or heart disease.
Yeah, why is the blurring of vision important for us?
Amaraxis fugax, sir. It's a fugax. Sign of transient ischemic attacks, and patients that have transient ischemic attacks have an increased risk for stroke.
Yeah, that is one thing. Second thing you should remember is, you know, the internal carotid artery, right? So we have common carotid artery, we have external carotid artery, and we have internal carotid artery. Okay, we have the cervical part, we have the petrous part, we have the cavernous part, as well as we have the intracranial part. There are four parts basically. Okay, the terminal branch of internal carotid artery, as you remember, it includes anterior carotid artery, it includes anterior cerebral artery, middle cerebral artery, posterior communicating artery, so as well as ophthalmic artery. Okay, so the ophthalmic artery origin comes from the internal carotid artery. Okay, so are we dealing with a disease where the same artery is being shared between two different sites? That is what is important for us. Okay. Is the ophthalmic artery is being involved? So is it a sign of, see, it could be the visual symptoms could be a transient ischemic attacks in the past, or it could be an association with the present stroke. Okay. So are we having any warning signs in the past? So that tells us, or that heralds the presence of future stroke. That is what is important for us. Okay. Second thing is, especially in elderly population, we have heard a disease called temporal arteritis. Okay. Though these people also can have, they may also have increased risk of stroke, and they may also have visual symptoms or visual obscurations. Third thing is migraine. Okay. So migraine patients can also have a lot of visual symptoms. And sometimes if migraine gets complicated, we call it as migraineous infarctions. So migraine also can cause stroke-like illness. Okay. So visual symptoms are important for these three or four reasons. And one more thing would be connective tissue disorders, where you have systemic symptoms. You can have eye symptoms, you can have brain symptoms, as well as other systemic symptoms. So whenever you ask a history, there are three things, as I told earlier. So what is the etiology probably we are dealing with? What is the other organ that is probably being involved? And does it make a difference in our treatment? That is what is our emphasis on. Okay. This is the idea behind asking a visual disturbance in case of a stroke. Okay. So did epilepsy, does it make any difference with stroke? Why did you ask history of epilepsy in this case?
If there is a history of seizures.
No, that's what. Whether epilepsy will increase the risk of stroke, or it is just a part of stroke. So there are two things. Okay. So epilepsy, basically, if a patient has got an epilepsy and a Torts palsy, it may mimic a stroke. Okay. So when you examine the patient, your patient will have right side weakness. If there is no eyewitness, we don't know what has happened. You think it could be a stroke mimicker. Okay. That is one thing. Okay. Second thing is, if epilepsy, seizures are one of the heralding features of an embolic stroke. Sometimes an embolic stroke patient can have seizures. Okay. Or sometimes in a TIA called limb shaking TIA, where there may be transient movements of the limbs, which can mimic seizures. But in fact, the etiology may be underlying TIA, transient ischemic attack. Okay. So before we write off epilepsy as idiopathic or generalized or genetic epilepsy, always make sure that we are not missing something. Okay. So limb shaking TIA, if you had missed, it would actually be disastrous. It can lead to a major stroke. Okay. So whenever you have a so-called seizures, so always dissect it. Is it, what is the idea behind, what is the, cause behind the seizure probably has to be very carefully looked into. Okay. Good. You have taken a good history. Go ahead.
Family history, no similar complaints in the family and no significant history.
Yeah. Can stroke run in families?
Yes, sir. There are certain conditions in Fabry's disease, CADASIL, CARASIL.
Very good. Excellent. That is a very good answer from an MBA student. Good. So many genetic factors are autosomal dominant. Okay. So CADASIL is dominant, recessive inheritances are there. Mitochondrial disorders can run in families, and many of the hemoglobinopathies, sickle cell anemias, polycythemias. Okay. So many of the myeloproliferative disorders may have a genetic basis which can present with stroke. Okay. Some of the connective tissue disorders having HLA inheritance, okay, HLA pattern may also have recurrent strokes in the family. Okay. Sometimes migraine, we call it as hemiplegic migraine or alternating hemiplegia of childhood. So they may also have a lot of genetic predisposition which can cause recurrent strokes in the family. Okay. So if family history of stroke is there, you should always think of a genetic etiology of various Mendelian inheritance. It could be a sporadic, it could be one of the types of Mendelian inheritances. Okay. Then we should be very careful looking into the pedigree chart of the patient, because you have to select on the gene analysis or the genetic counseling to the patient, so that we prevent or we try to advise the patients in the future. Okay. That is the importance of this. Okay. Yeah.
Yes, personal history, diet. He has been on a liquid diet after admission, but he was on a mixed diet before admission. Appetite is normal, sleep is sound. Bladder, he is able to walk to the washroom and empty bladder on his own. There is no history of dribbling of urine. Bowel movements are normal. There is no history of smoking or alcohol intake and no history of high-risk behavior.
Yeah. Can you tell me when the bladder will be involved in the case of stroke? Is it common to have a bladder involvement in a stroke?
No, sir. Only if it's the anterior cerebral artery, the paracaudal region, that can cause...
Yeah, one is the area, paracentral lobule, the area what you are talking about. Second thing would be, it should be generally bilateral. In unilateral disease, generally there is a composition from the other side, okay? So even if you have a bladder involvement, it will be transient thing in unilateral strokes. It is not a persisting thing, okay? Or if there is a combination of spinal cord plus brain involvement, something else, not in stroke, some other disorders, then you can have combination, okay? Otherwise, bladder involvement is generally not a common phenomenon. And be very careful here. You have written, he's able to walk to the washroom, okay? Able to walk means his power should be nearly more than 4. That is very important. Okay. I don't know about the power in the future. We'll see. But this is very important for us. Okay. So you should be able to write, whenever you write walk to the washroom, you should be careful. Your power should be at least 4 or more. three generally patient will be able to defend against gravity, but walking becomes difficult without unaided. Okay. So every sentence what we write in exam becomes very significant. Okay. So we'll see in the future. Okay. This is very important. Okay. Yeah. So there is no history of smoking, no history of alcohol, recent diabetes, recent hypertension. Practically, there are no risk factors for this gentleman. Okay. Only 48-year-old. So probably we have to dig in more and more and more and find out the causes of stroke here. Okay. Because, you know, risk factors are not very impressive. Either he has been diagnosed late of hypertension and diabetes, or even if it is only of 1 month onset, then we might have to find out more causes of the stroke here. Okay. Because it doesn't have very impressive risk factors to cause stroke. Okay. Yeah. Go ahead.
Summary: a hypertensive and diabetic middle-aged man with sudden onset progressive hemiparesis of right side, including the lower half of right side of face, associated with aphasia. No history suggestive of sensory deficits or any other cranial nerve involvement other than Neumann lesion of seventh cranial nerve innervating right side of face. History is suggestive of acute neurological deficit, probably due to ischemic stroke involving the left middle cerebral artery territory.
Yeah, I think we have discussed everything here. So we have motor involvement, we have speech involvement, as well as we have a facial nerve involvement. Okay, so three things are there. That probably, so there are two things. There is lateralization and there is localization. Okay. So lateralization is right or left side. Localization is where, within there where. Okay. So I think you briefly know about how the cerebral arteries are, how their circulation is, everything. Okay. Can you tell me which artery does not directly contribute to circle of Willis? So we have anterocerebral artery, we have postcerebral artery, we have posterior communicating artery, we have anterocommunicating artery. But remember, it is the ICA which comes in. Okay. MCA will be on the other side. So MCA does not have direct role in the circle of Willis. It is on the lateral side. Okay. So circle of Willis is very important for all of us, because here circle of Willis is an important area. See, where, you know, the blood circulation is there is a distribution happens, and it may also compensate to a certain extent, although it is not a foolproof thing. Okay. So here what is important is, can you tell me, let us say it is not stroke. Mahima, let us think it is not stroke. Any other thing can produce a deficit like this? This is very important when you think of a differential diagnosis, because in our undergraduate curriculum, generally the concept of DDs are not given much importance. We only think of the disease and the diagnosis, and we try to fit in everything into that diagnosis what we need. Okay. So can you, any other disease present like this, other than, let us say it is not due to ischemic stroke. Let us say patient does not have, I'll do an MRI. I will tell MRI is normal. So it will be, you know, see, in a clinician, will be more in trouble. Clinician will be more in trouble when the investigation becomes negative, when the investigation is not positive. Okay. Because you have to explain to the relatives, you have to explain to yourself what is happening to the patient. Let us say if MRI is normal, can it be anything else?
Demyelination.
So there is entity called, yeah, there is entity called MRI negative stroke. Okay. So sometimes in MRI to pick up stroke may take some time. It may be still stroke. Sometimes even 24 hours, even although MRI is very sensitive to pick up stroke, it may sometimes take a longer time to pick up stroke. We have seen in our practice taking 24 to 36 hours to pick up stroke, even with a deficient sequence. Okay. So either it is a missed stroke in a radiological imaging. Sometimes clinical pattern can precede radiology. That is the importance of clinical medicine. Okay. So clinical findings are there. Even if MRI is negative, still you have to treat like a stroke till, you know, may have to repeat the imaging and see. Or else mimic stroke mimickers, or else you rule out stroke mimickers, okay, which you have described already. So even in the metabolic disturbances may have lot of stroke mimickers presenting or mimicking like a stroke. That is the importance of knowing about the stroke mimickers. Okay. Sometimes a tumor with a bleed can mimic something like this. Sometimes a large demyelinating plaque or a demyelinating lesion mimic like a stroke. Okay. Sometimes a spontaneous intracranial, intracerebral bleed due to any other cause may mimic like this. Okay. So it may not be always ischemic stroke, although ischemic strokes are more common, many of the other causes also should be kept in mind. See, whatever the pattern we tell, headache, the vomiting, raised ICT, all these things, the onset of symptom, the stroke in evolution, they are not very strict. In practice, other things, you know, it can slightly, the lines can blur, okay? Hemorrhagic stroke sometimes can mimic like an ischemic stroke can mimic like a hemorrhagic stroke, CVT can mimic like an ischemic stroke. It is not very, you know, the lines are not very strict. So we have to be a little bit considerate when we investigate a patient so that we encompass on everything. We don't miss anything. Okay. So probably for undergraduate level, this is probably an ischemic stroke of left-sided hemispheric lesion. Okay. We'll go into the individual lateralization and localization later. We'll proceed.
General physical examination. Middle-aged man who is moderately built and nourished is conscious and cooperative and well-oriented to time, place, and person. Patient is right-handed. Pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, lymphadenopathy, and pedal edema are not seen. Vitals, the pulse was 71
beats. One minute, Mayama, can you just go to the previous slide? 1 minute, sorry. So you told well oriented to time, place, and person. Is he speaking?
So we asked yes and no questions. He wasn't able
to. Okay. So that is very important. Okay. If it has global aphasia, never make a mistake of telling orientation. Okay. So that is one of the fallacies of our many of the higher mental function testing. So that it will be MoCA or MMSC or even NIH score sometimes. So we actually underestimate the aphasia. Aphasia is a focal deficit. We call it as basically the eloquent area. That particular area is affected, that particular structure is affected, and that particular function is affected. So what happens is when you assess the patient overall, this aphasia can confuse us many times. We may miss into different things. You may miss into some people can miss into altered sensorium. Many of the times it can happen. So if patient is not talking, they think patient is not conscious, his sensorium is not proper. That is one thing. Second thing, even in the case of right hemispheric stroke, let us say right hemisphere is involved, patient may have severe apathy. A severely apathetic patient may not speak. Okay. So you talk to the patient is not interested in you. Why does he doesn't want to speak to you? So severe apathy can mimic like aphasia. Okay. That is one thing. Second thing, in the right hemispheric stroke, there may be dysprosody. Prosody may not be normal. Okay. So his speech may not be proper. So don't expect his speech to be normal, even in the case of right hemispheric stroke. There may be prosody abnormality or there may be apathy. So these two things should be very carefully seen that we don't miss those things. Okay. So orientation should be very carefully seen. The moment patient is well oriented, we are actually a little bit relieved, because orientation in neurology is very, very important. The consciousness and orientation is very important. The moment patient's orientation goes, that is a red flag. Okay. We may be dealing with a larger disease, a more severe disease. That is why this word of orientation is very important. You would have known the definition of delirium, no? So delirium is basically disorientation, lack of orientation. So orientation becomes extremely important for us. Okay. Now, pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, lymphedema, edema, you have written the pickles. Okay. So what is the importance of this in stroke? Where do you get pallor with stroke? Can you tell me? Why did you ask for a pallor in this particular gentleman?
Vitamin B12 deficiencies can cause subacute combined degeneration.
Stroke. We are talking about stroke, right? We'll stick to stroke.
Okay. If the patient has something like sickle cell anemia, that can cause.
Okay. It can cause thrombotic state. It can cause occlusion of blood vessels. Polycythemia can also cause same thing. So many of the hemoglobinopathies can cause same thing. Many of the myeloproliferative disorders can also cause the same thing. They may all have a pallor as a presentation. Okay. Or patient is on many of the, some of the blood thinners. For example, patient is taking blood thinner for a long time, has got a bleed, okay, GA bleed, which made him to develop pallor, and now he develops an intracranial bleed. Patient is on anticoagulation, had a GA bleed for a long time, now he develops intracranial bleed. Okay, so pallor indicates, or it could be an infected endocarditis. Very, very important. Okay, so patient of an infected endocarditis can have anemia, pallor. Okay, they can also have icterus. So whenever you see a pallor in a patient of stroke, it may be hypothyroidism. Hypothyroid patients can also be pale. Okay, so anemia itself is a risk factor for stroke. Remember this: anemia is a risk factor for stroke, both for arterial as well as venous stroke. Okay, so anemia can also cause CVD, cerebral venous thrombosis. Anemia can also cause ischemic strokes. Okay, so anemia could be a cause of stroke. Anemia could be an effect as well, because of the underlying primary pathology. Okay, so probably we are dealing with a much larger spectrum here when we see a patient who has got a pallor. Okay, icterus is very important because it could be a same disease which is involving liver plus brain. Okay, for example, disseminated tuberculosis or a miliary tuberculosis, having CNS involvement, having vasculitic infarct, having stroke. Okay, or patient is on certain drugs which can cause jaundice. That may be an association factor. Okay, or it could be an infected endocarditis having stroke plus icterus. Or a patient has got sepsis, septic infarcts, then also patient can have icterus plus stroke. Okay, so these are the various things. There are many more you can think of. You can think of systemic disorder, connective tissue disorder, having autoimmune hepatitis as well as autoimmune disease causing stroke. Okay, so many things can cause combination of jaundice plus stroke. Okay, cyanosis plus stroke is also very important. For a patient has got fallot tetralogy, develops very high risk factor for cerebral abscess, so develops stroke. Okay, so it could be a stroke mimicker, by the way. Okay, or patient has got a paradoxical embolus, then develops a stroke. Okay, patient has got a severe cyanosis because of hypoxia. Hypoxia itself can cause stroke. Hypercapnia itself can cause stroke-like symptoms. Hypoxia and hypercapnia also can cause papilledema, raised ICT. Okay, so these are the importance of looking into cyanosis. Okay, clubbing is because there may be malignancies, or there may be tuberculosis, there may be abscesses elsewhere. Okay, there may be abscess in the brain as well. Okay, so all can mimic like stroke. So the pickle what you write is not just for the completion sake, because each of them can have an association with the stroke. That is the importance of us. Okay. And lymphadenopathy is very, very important. So recently I had seen a patient who has got a cervical lymph nodes develop stroke. It was basically due to tuberculosis. Okay. So lymphadenopathy is very important. So you have to palpate the patient from top to bottom to find out certain clinical clues, which are very crucial for us to make a diagnosis. Okay. So lymphadenopathy could be due to TB, could be due to some of the malignancies. There may be metastasis to the brain. It could be a lymphoma. Okay. Or it could be any of the metastatic malignancies. So these are all the possibilities when you think of a lymphadenopathy. Okay. And pedal edema is very, very important because cardiac plus brain. So there may be CCF, there may be stroke. Okay. So always heart and brain may go hand in hand. So both pathologies are basically same. So then this could produce combination of edema plus stroke. Or if patient has got a hypertensive crisis, hypertensive emergency or hypertensive urgency, where patient has got an acute LVF and he develops CCF, he develops pedal edema, he develops renal failure, he develops stroke. Okay. There you have to be very much aggressive on the BP management, hypertensive management. Okay. That is the importance of looking into all of these things. Okay. So see patient as a whole in a holistic approach so that we don't miss anything. Okay. So pan-Richter, sinus clubbing, and lymphedema with an edema are not just for the pickle. They add spice to our clinical examination as well as to make a diagnosis. Okay. So it will help us to point out what is the etiology we are talking about, what is the disease we are talking about. Okay. Yeah, go ahead.
Vitals, the pulse was 71 beats per minute, regular, normal in volume and character. Respiratory rate was 16 cycles per minute, which is abdominal thoracic type. BP was 140 by 94 of millimeters of mercury in left brachial artery. Temperature was 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit.
Yeah, here respiratory, you have written abdominal thoracic pattern. Does it make any difference, respiratory pattern and stroke? If you are unable to answer, I can tell you. If you can attempt, I'll be very happy. Put in attempt. Respiratory pattern, when you examine the patient of stroke, you see into his respiratory pattern. Does it warn you? Does it give any red flag?
Like chain stroke pattern, apneustic breathing.
Yeah, there are lots of patterns of breathing, right? So we have a midbrain, we have central neurogenic hyperventilation, we have apneustic breathing, we have Biot's breathing in medulla, we have a cavotic breathing. Okay, there are medullary breathing. There are a lot of patterns of breathing. Okay, so looking to what you should, at least an undergraduate should understand is basically pattern of breathing and the stroke. Okay, if there is any deviation of the normal breathing pattern, we may be dealing with the raised ICT or we may be dealing with a disease which is affecting the brainstem. Okay, so that should warn us so that we should be very careful with the patient. And if a patient has got apneustic breathing or any of these things, so you should be more careful with those patients, but you have to categorize them for a higher severity of stroke, and we should be careful with those patients. Okay, so if patient is comfortably breathing, then we are very, very happy. If there is any abnormal pattern of breathing, we may be dealing with a stroke in the brainstem, or we may be dealing with a raised ICT. Okay, this is very important. Okay, here important to remember is to palpate every artery possible. Okay, right and left is very important, including the lower limbs. So we may have a dissection of aorta. We may have Takayasu arteritis, we may have vasculitis, we may have subclavian steel syndrome. Maybe too much for you, but what I'm trying to tell you is each artery has to be palpable, then only we are happy. Okay, if one artery is not palpable, lower limbs are not palpable, we may be dealing with a dissection, we may be dealing with a quiet action of aorta, or we may be dealing with a subclavian artery stenosis. So any of these things, okay? So, this arterial, generally we tend to neglect all these things because every arm you have to record blood pressure, every arm you have to palpate the pulse, that we don't miss anything. Okay, especially the systemic connective tissue disorders, especially the vasculitic etiologies, considering the patient is young. Okay, especially in the younger population, younger cohort with no major risk factors, so all these things become extremely important for us. Okay, and some older examiners will also expect you to look for the blue and other things. Probably you will be telling it in the CVS examination. Okay, yeah. So temperature, I think I already told. So fever could be seen in various conditions of stroke, and especially the pontine things, you should never forget the three P's of pontine lesion. Okay, so BP is also very important. Okay, because we have got treatment modalities. So the treatment, the target BP is very crucial for a stroke patient. When you go into your MD and other post graduation, you will know how much to reduce BP, how frequent you have to reduce BP, or what should be your target BP. So these are all the important aspects in our management. That is why we look into all these things. Okay, yeah, go ahead.
Higher mental functions. The patient was right-handed individual. He is conscious and cooperative. He is well-oriented to time, place, and person. Appearance and behavior seemed appropriate. Patient is emotionally stable. Calculation was normal. Speech fluency is markedly reduced. Incoherent sounds made. Repetition is absent. Comprehension is present. Patient is able to read and follow.
Yeah, here one important thing I'd like to ask here. See, what happens here is when you tell speech fluency is markedly reduced, there are incoherent sounds made, repetition is absent, means it's quite severe form of aphasia. Okay. So such a patient, it is extremely difficult to make the calculation. Okay, so patient will not be able to tell. It's because see, aphasia is not just about it's about expressing oneself. Even writing will be affected. Even reading will be affected in the case of aphasia. That too, aphasia is something like this. Okay, here you should be very. I'll take with a pinch of salt. Be careful when you comment on calculation. You may not be able to do it. To be sincere with you. Okay. Second thing is even the orientation part of it. Time, place, and person, all three are very difficult in a patient who has aphasia. Okay. So you can be sincere with yourself, and you can just tell to the examiner, because patient has got aphasia, that too, probably Broca's aphasia, I am not able to comment on these things. So that is absolutely fine. Okay. There is nothing to be worried about. You can as well directly tell the examiner, these things I am unable to comment. Okay. This is very important. Okay. Oh, and when somebody else was. Yeah, just a minute. Somebody else was asking about the checking BP in the affected limb. Yeah, that is basically what happens in a case of stroke is on the affected limb, the vasomotor tone will be low. Okay. So your BP may be erroneous. So try to check. There are two things. One thing is whenever you put a cannula, vasofix or cannula to the patient, try to avoid the paralyzed limb. Okay. And as well, when you check the BP, you should be careful to check on the both sides because of the difference in vasomotor tone, whatever you're recording may not be the appropriate recording. Okay. This you have to keep in mind whenever you record a BP of a stroke patient. Okay. So consciousness is absolutely appreciated, but regarding orientation and speech, be careful. And you have to try to see that, we don't make a mistake with this. Okay. So comprehension being present, patient's fluency being low, okay, and patient's repetition being poor, and probably grammar. I think grammar is not mentioned. Grammar also must be proven. We call it as agrammatism, agrammatic speech. Okay. So probably we are dealing with an anterior aphasia. Okay. So let us just in a nutshell, I'll brief about aphasia here only. For an undergraduate student, what is required? Okay. We divide into anterior aphasia and posterior aphasias, or you can divide it into extrasylvian and perisylvian aphasias. Okay. What is important for us is whether the repetition part is preserved or not, whether the comprehension part is preserved or not, whether the expression part is preserved or not. We know all that common things, Broca's, the Wernicke's, the transcortical motor, the transcortical sensory, the transcortical mixed and global aphasias. Okay. So remember that transcortical motor and sensory is similar to Wernicke's, Broca's and Wernicke's with preserved repetition, and transcortical mixed is similar to global with preserved repetition. Okay. And global is all the components being affected. So here, see, our undergraduate teaching is about the areas. We know Broca's area, inferior frontal lobe, Wernicke's area, superior temporal lobe, okay? And we have that arcuate bundle and other things. But with the advancements, what you should remember, also should remember is now it is about networks, not about the zones, not about the areas, okay? So Broca's area is actually not just in the Broca's area, it is actually about the network, okay? So speech and language has evolved with functional MRIs and other advancements, and we more talk about networks now. It is about network hypothesis, okay? So you would have seen a patient who has got a mixture of clinical picture. He examined today, he has got a Broca's aphasia. You examined, they have two days later, he has got a transcortical motor aphasia. Then after 1 week, you have got a mini Broca's aphasia. Okay. So it can keep changing. The pattern can keep changing. So examiner, if you shouts at you, you should be able to explain to the examiner that, no, sir, yesterday it was this and today it was this. It can actually change. Okay. So speech is not a definite thing. It can keep changing every day. Okay. So I think you heard of mini Broca's. Have you any idea about mini Broca's aphasia?
No, sir.
If it is only on the Broca's area, only the speech part being affected, then we probably call it as mini Broca's aphasia. Other expression may be normal here. Okay. Some people also use a word called apraxia of speech. There are a lot of confusions and controversy in this statement, but for your level, this is more than enough. Okay. So this is very important. So the moment you tell Broca's aphasia, there may be, along with that aphasia, there may be agraphia. There may be difficulty in reading, difficulty in writing, as well as one thing you remember, Mahima, it is a little bit too much for MBBS level, maybe little bit of comprehension can also be affected in Broca's aphasia. It is not absolute. Okay. This with the evolution of knowledge, you will come to learn, when you become go to PG, you will be learning it on the better way. So even in the Wernicke's area, there may be some amount of affection on the talking part of it. Even in Broca's area, there may be some affection of the comprehension part of it. It is not an absolute watertight compartment. Okay. So because of the pathogenesis and the networks I was talking about, it is not a watertight area. So there may be some amount of affection of comprehension, even in the case of Broca's aphasia. Okay. So when you examine a lot of stroke patients, you will gradually come to know their response may not be quick. Okay. They may take a very longer time to respond. You would have noticed in your wards. Okay. They are not as quick as us. That may be due to a part of comprehension normality in the case of Broca's aphasia. Okay. So if the examiner asks you why comprehension is taking a lot of time, why there is delayed response, this could be your answer so that you can defend yourself. Okay. So other patterns of aphasia, I think all of you know, so I don't want to repeat everything. So remember, the anterior part is generally expression and posterior part is generally comprehension. And these are the crucial things you would be looking into when a patient has got aphasia. Okay. Yeah. So patient is able to read and follow, you have written. So that means the severity is probably less. Okay. It is not a very severe form of aphasia. And that may be an explanation for you to tell that, to defend yourself that regarding orientation. Okay. So these things you can use in your defense. Okay. So probably either the aphasia is recovering now or aphasia is not that severe to cause him functionally hampered to do other things. Okay. Yeah. Go ahead.
Cranial nerve examination. The examination of olfactory nerve was normal. Examination of optic nerve was also normal with counting for visual acuity, counting fingers at 6 meters, visual field normal by confrontation technique, round and reactive pupils, which are 4 millimeter in size, and color vision was normal. Fundoscopy was not done.
Yeah, here very, very important thing is, probably what is the most important thing here for us as clinicians, the pupil, okay? The pupil size is very, very important for us, okay? If there is an anisocoria, we are in trouble, okay? We have to be very, very careful. We have to be very, very vigilant, okay? There are two possibilities. Either there is also a lesion in the midbrain, which is causing third nerve pulsing, or it is a sign of raised ICT, okay? And impending herniation, okay? Moment you see an asymmetric pupil in your ward, and that case is given to you, you have to warn your postgraduate or staff, okay? Because it is very crucial. So we cannot miss it, okay? So anisocoria pupil becomes extremely important for us, and we cannot be relaxed at that point of time, okay? Does he have any, we'll go to the third, fourth, proceed, Naima, go ahead.
Oculomotor trochlear abducens on the right was normal, as well as on the left. Pupil, again, size was 4 millimeters, shape was normal, right, light reflex was present, both direct and indirect, and extraocular movements are normal.
Does he have any gaze palsy? Where his eye was turning to? It was turning to the right or turning to the left? Does he have any? You have to make a mention here, okay? In a stroke patient, there may be gaze palsy. I think you know about the gaze palsies. Gaze palsy is basically conjugate. Both eyes have to move together, right? We have something called frontal eye field, area number 8, historically, okay? So that will move the eye to the opposite side. Right frontal field will move to the eye to the left side, and left will move to the right side, okay? In a case of an epileptic phenomena, let us say seizure phenomena, it originated from the left frontal lobe. Eye will have an adversive movement of the head to the right side, and in eye will also tend to go to the right side, okay? If there is a destructive phenomenon on the left side, then eye may go back to the left side, okay? That is very important, okay? So the gaze of the patient is very important, okay? One more thing is whether the dorsal eye reflex is present or absent, okay? Turn the head to the right side, eye has to go to the left side. Turn the head to the left side, eye has to go to the right side. If this becomes absent, if it is not there, then we may be dealing with a brainstem disease, okay? It may not be a cortical stroke. Generally, in a cortical phenomena, dorsal eye reflex will be preserved, okay? So these two things are very crucial for us. Whenever you see a stroke patient, the presence of a gaze palsy and presence of a dorsal eye movement or not is also gives us some of the clues regarding the localization, okay? So this we have to very carefully see in a stroke patient. When you see a lot of stroke patients, you will come to know. Their eye will be generally pointing only to one side, okay? So that we can tell whether it is a destructive lesion or a radiative lesion. Accordingly, we can tell what is the type of lesion patient is probably having, okay? That is the importance of third, fourth, and sixth nerve, okay? One more important thing is presence of sixth nerve palsy can be a false localizing sign, okay? Any cases of raised ICT may have sixth nerve palsy as a false localizing sign. So we need not go into the pons to make a diagnosis of sixth nerve palsy. It may be just a false localizing sign. Practically speaking, every cranial nerve can have a false localizing sign. But for an undergraduate level, we should remember that sixth nerve palsy is probably the most common false localizing sign. If you know, can you tell me why it has happened? Why is it so common to have a false localizing sign? It is a long course. Plus, whenever the ICT gets raised, it gets pinched on the petrous apex. Okay, the petrous apex bone gets, it gets pinched on over there. That is the reason why you tend to have a false localizing sign in case of sixth nerve palsy. Okay, yeah, go ahead.
Trigeminal was normal on both right and left. Sensory sensations were present over the forehead, cheek, chin, Motor was normal. Jawjaw, corneal, and conjunctival reflexes were normal.
Yeah, here everything is very important for us. Okay, so for example, let us say conjunctival reflex is absent or a corneal reflex is absent. We have to be very careful. Okay, bilateral absence, disease is much more severe. Patient is definitely worsening. Unilateral absence, probably either the fifth nerve is gone or a seventh nerve is gone. Okay. So efferent is fifth nerve, efferent is seventh nerve. I think you know very well. And second thing is corneal and conjunctival dissociation. Okay. If presence of corneal reflex and absence of conjunctival reflex, presence of conjunctival reflex and absence of corneal reflex. Can you tell me, can you know where does it happen like this? Can you have a dissociation? Because you do both, right? Why do you do both corneal and conjunctival? Both are fifth nerve. What is the fun of doing both reflexes? It is because
different.
Coronary is generally pain reflex. Okay, the nucleus for the pain reflex is different, and congenital is generally touch reflex. So, okay, so we have a nucleus of different nucleus of trigeminal nerve, right? We have a nucleus of spinal tract of trigeminal nerve. We have a chief sensory nucleus. You have mesenchymal nucleus as well as you have motor nucleus. Okay, so pain is predominantly by corneal, and touch is predominantly by conjunctival reflex. Okay, that is why we do both. Okay, because you know trigeminal nerve has got a very long course. It goes down to the spinal cord, and you know, we have a contralamic tract as well. Okay, that is the reason why this is important for us. Okay, so this is importance of looking into the corneal and conjunctival reflex separately. Okay, is it a pain or is it a touch reflex? And Jaw jerk is basically, we know, it is by the fifth nerve. So jaw jerk generally in unilateral disease is not that significant. In a bilateral disease, for example, multiple strokes in the past, multi-infarct states, okay, or patient has got dementia because of multi-infarct states in the past, then we may have an exaggerated jaw jerk, okay? And patient may also have many of the emotional problems. They can have emotional lability, emotional incontinence, crying episodes, laughing episodes. Then those things, your jaw jerk becomes more significant. In a case of acute stroke, it may not be that important for us, okay? And sensory, as I told, trigeminal, we have different patterns of sensory loss. I hope you know about it. On and pill pattern of sensory loss, we have the lamination, that V1, V2, V3 lamination, as well as perioral versus peripheral. Okay. So is it a rostral lesion? Is it a caudal lesion? Is it a V1 lesion? Is it a V2 lesion or a V3 lesion? Accordingly, we can judge and tell our localization looking into the sensory loss in the case of patient of stroke. Okay. Yeah, go ahead.
Facial nerve on the right. Forehead wrinkling is present, ability to close eyes present. There is absence of nasolabial fold, inability to puff out cheeks, and deviation of angle of mouth to left. Anterior two-third taste present. The examination on the left was normal. Deviation of the angle of the mouth was seen on the left.
So here, normal side has pulled. Okay, so normal side pulls in case of, what are the cranial nerves? One is 7 nerves. Yeah, so you will also will be pulled to the normal side, whereas jaw deviates to the abnormal side, and tongue, you know, right? There is a pushing effect. Okay, so that is why. So on inside the tongue, things will be different. Hello, sorry, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes,
so yeah.
So you're visible.
Yeah, but I'm sorry, I have some problem with the screen. Okay, yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah. So tongue, what happens is inside the tongue, things are different, and out, when you pull the tongue out, things are different. Okay. So whenever you pull the tongue out, it will be deviating to the, see here, there will be pushing effect by the normal sided genioglossus muscle. Okay. Whereas inside, it will be on the opposite side. Okay. So fifth nerve, seventh nerve, ninth nerve, and tenth nerve. Here, we have to comment on the deviation on one side or on the both sides. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Go ahead.
The examinations of vestibular cochlear nerve on both sides was normal.
Okay.
The examination of glossopharyngeal and vagus nerves were also normal on both sides.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. So basically, what I am trying to tell you is the lower cranial nerves are absolutely normal here, except for the presence of seventh nerve. There is nothing else here. Okay. So yes, as I told earlier, presence of lower cranial nerves indicates either a multiple lesion or we are having a false localizing sign. Okay. Yeah. Go ahead.
The examination of spinal accessory nerve on both sides was normal, with normal power of sternocleidomastoid and trapezius seen. And examination of hypoglossal nerve was also normal. There was a normal tone of the tongue and no deviations or fasciculations.
Okay, see, fasciculations probably you may not have to comment here, because fasciculations are a sign of long-standing strokes or a long-standing disease, okay? Something like a motor neuron disease or a multi-infarct state. The acute stroke, you don't generally get any fasciculations, and fasciculations, see, certain things you do not expect at all, you may not comment, okay? And if you are dealing with this patient of motor neuron, is absolutely justified. For a stroke, you may not comment on the fasciculations, okay? Yeah.
Motor examination, attitude of the patient is supine, with shoulder adducted, flexion at elbow, flexion at wrist, and semi-pronated arm. This is of the right arm. And the right lower limb is externally rotated with extension at hip and knee.
Can you tell me why this attitude is important for us in a stroke patient?
The involvement of muscles in a human lesion, more of anti-gravity muscles.
Excellent. Yeah, so you have a flexor hypertonia of upper limb and extensor hypertonia of the lower limb. Okay. And the affection of muscles is other way around. See, this, the creator has done it so beautifully, so that the patient is still able to walk. Okay. If extensors of lower limb are involved and flexors of upper limb, if extensors of lower limb were to be involved, then what would have happened is patient would not be able to walk, okay? Because extensors are relatively spared, patient is still able to walk. So upper limb will be in a flexed posture and lower limb will be in extended posture. Because of that, at least patient is able to walk despite having a stroke. That is the beauty of our creator, who has thought about the strokes in when he created us. So he has made the differential involvement of flexors and extensors so that, you know, at least patient of stroke is still able to walk. That is the ideal way of describing a hemiplegic posture. So whenever a patient of hemiplegia walks to you, this is the reason for the differential innervation of the flexors and extensor muscles. Okay, yeah, good. Go ahead.
There's no change in bulk in both sides. Yeah. Measurements in both sides was the same.
Yeah, good.
Tone. Right upper limb, both arm and forearm were hypotonic. And left was normal. And in the lower limb, both thigh and leg were hypotonic and left was normal.
Why is the hypotonia here?
Neurogenic shock, sir.
Okay. What is this shock stage? What? How long does it last? Do you have any idea?
Up to 6 weeks.
Yeah, up to 4 to 8 weeks has been described in textbooks. Okay. So basically, the UMN inhibition that is taken off will produce an exaggerated signs in case of UMN disease. Okay. When the inhibition is taken off, it becomes exaggeration. But this can take some time. Okay. There are different pathogenesis and hypotheses for that. I don't want to go into the details of it. But you should remember that shock stage is cessation of movements and reflex activity. Okay, can happen. It can persist for a quite a longer period of time. And the pattern of recovery is also very important. Okay. It is about the reflex, tone, and power. That is how the pattern recovers. Okay. Probably the reflex comes first, then comes the tone, then comes the power. Okay. So you examine the patient in the ward. Today you examine, after 4 days also you examine. The biceps which was absent started to appear. That is a good sign. Okay. Then the tone which is hypotonic becoming hypertonic is a good sign. Okay. Then comes the power improvement, okay? Because the hypertonia in a case is a boon, it's not a bane, okay? Because of hypertonia, at least limb is stiff. A stiff limb will make the patient at least walk, okay? If patient is totally hypotonic, patient is not be able to walk. This is very important for our practice. See, we use certain drugs called anti-spastic medication in a case of stroke. Patient has got a lot of spasticity in a stroke, it will have a lot of something called flexor spasm. It has a lot of stiffness, has got involuntary movements and pain. So then when you treat, we should be very careful, okay? We have to balance on the tone. A too much of hypotonia will actually make the patient not be able to walk, okay? So we have to balance out our medications when we treat spasticity. That is why we have to comment on the tone, okay? So I think that the basics of tone, as a undergraduate student, you should know what is the definition of tone, the idea behind tone, different, you know, influences of tone, all these things are important. If you're examining the patient when the patient is sleeping, we'll have an apparent hypotonia, okay? If he's awake, the probability tone will be much better. So the state of examination also becomes important, okay? And the recovery of tone probably is a sign of shock stage, that is waning off or a fading off, okay? Yeah. So here it is uniformly upper limb and lower limb are hypotonic, right? Go ahead.
Yes. Power. In the shoulder, it was 3 for all movements, 3 out of 5 on the right. And on the left, it was normal. At the elbow joint, there was movement only when gravity was removed. And in the wrist, there was only a flicker of contraction.
Okay.
For the leg, the power was 3. Movement against gravity was present. And on the left, it was normal. For the knee, again, only movement against gravity for the ankle and toe movements as well.
Yeah, see here, what happens is in acute stroke, when patient is coming in the acute stage, this difference of the extensors, flexors, and all, you may not be able to make out much, especially if patient is aphasic, okay? When the stroke starts improving, then the differentiation becomes, the pattern becomes more clear, okay? In acute stages, I will not expect you to tell the pattern very clearly because it is very difficult. Some, you know, it appears like all the movements are uniformly affected, okay? But when the recovery starts, you will classically notice that the fine coordinated movements, the dexterity of the limb is very severely affected. If you can remember, the earliest sign of a pyramidal tract disease is loss of dexterity. Okay, so patient who was using the right hand is unable to do the things in the right hand. He may prefer using the left hand. Okay, so loss of dexterity and even the thumb going inside. Okay, the thumb patient may not be able to keep the thumb like this. Okay, so these are some of the earliest features of pyramidal tract lesion. So loss of dexterity becomes very important sign of an early pyramidal tract disease. Okay, that is why the importance of right hand left things comes. Okay, and regarding power, it is whatever grade is appreciated. But remember, when you write a power of around 2 or 3 in the upper and lower limb, make sure that walking part may be difficult independently. Okay, always around 4 minus or 4 you may patient may be able to walk. With three, it is very difficult for the patient to walk. Although it is against gravity, it doesn't allow the limb to be act as a fulcrum for propel the patient forward. Okay, so that you should be very careful on commenting on the power. Should take the entire picture together. The patient is walking, don't decrease power to so much that 2 or 3. So at least you have to make it 4 or 4 minus. Okay. So this minus and plus are arbitrarily used in multiple clinicians. So some people prefer to use that minus and plus, some may not prefer it. That depends on your individual examiners, but you should at least follow the MRC grading. What you have written is appreciated. Okay. Yeah. So he has got profound right-sided hemiparesis. He's not a plegia. He has got a paresis. That is what his interpretation, right? Yeah.
With the upper limb involved more than.
Excellent. Good.
Reflexes, superficial reflexes, corneal and conjunctival were present on both sides. Abdominal was absent on the right and present on the left. Plantar response on the right was an extensor response, while as on the left, it was a flexor response.
Yeah. See, abdominal reflex is very important in case of stroke as well as in case of motor neuron disease. Okay. See, MND is a disease where abdominal reflex is preserved till almost last stage. Okay. Whereas stroke is a disease where abdominal reflex is lost in early stage. Okay. So abdominal reflex also, the pattern and quadrants also become important. It may not be important for stroke if you are dealing with a segmental disease. Okay. Let us say TA, T10, T12. Then the segments become important. The loss of abdominal reflex in individual segments become important for us. Okay. So whenever you examine the abdominal reflex, so look into all the segments, and the differential loss of reflex may give a very important sign. I think you would heard about all the signs, right? Beaver sign and all. So all these things, you know, that is the importance of looking into the individual segments. Okay. So here it is, you know, what is expected is to have a right side absence of abdominal reflex. That is what is seen in the patient. Okay. So extensive plantar response also should be very, very careful. Sometimes what happens, it will be mute. If the power is 0/5, there is no dorsiflexion at all, then you will not get an extensor response. Okay. So whenever you comment on the extensor plantar, make sure that what is the power of the lower lip, especially in the element disease. In the UMN disease, still may patient may get an extensor response. In the element disease, when there is a foot drop, okay, there is no point in getting there may not be any response at all in the plantar. So either it is a mute response or it is a flexor response. Okay. So power of the dorsiflexor also is very important when you comment on the plantar response. So these all things you should run in your mind with a blueprint when you comment on individual signs, because each sign should go hand in hand with another sign. Okay. Because we shouldn't contradict to our own findings. That is the importance of it. Okay. So it may be mute in the early stage, or it will gradually become extensor with the progression of the lesion. And one more thing is, you might be surprised. Sometimes you expect a UMN disease and you get a flexor plantar. You would have had the same thing in your wards, right? Sometimes you think it's a UMN disease, but you are not getting an extensor plantar. Okay. You are bound to show an extensor plantar to the examiner. Okay. So there you may have to explain the examiner that only the fibers of those fibers which are responsible for causing extensor plantar, those fibers may be spared in certain patients. Okay. It is not that pyramidal tract lesion should have all the fibers being affected on one side. So those fibers responsible for the extensor plantar may be spared in the rare circumstances. That can cause, there may not be an extensor plantar in a patient who is supposed to have a UMN lesion. Okay. This is the probable explanation for certain patients for not having an extensor plantar response despite having a pyramidal tract lesion. Okay. So it is not, in undergraduate and in postgraduate level, it will be very strict that you have to get an extensor plantar response for a pyramidal tract lesion. As we evolve with neurology, we become more considerate. Okay. You may not have an extensor plantar in all UMN diseases. Okay. It is still possible. If you have other signs, your extensor plantar is not that hardcore sign. Okay. You have to take the entire clinical context, not just to harp on the only one particular sign. Okay. Anyway, this patient has got a classical sign of right hemiparesis along with the right extensor plantar, which makes our job easier. Okay. Yeah. Go ahead.
Deep reflexes, it was only 1+ in the right upper limb. Okay. Left upper limb showed normal reflex.
Yeah. Yeah. Here and expected presence of hypotonia. General and reflexes has gone hand in hand here, and probably the recovery stage is not yet started here. Okay, so we are in the early stage of the stroke, and there is hypotonia and there is hyporeflexia. Okay, yeah.
Sensory system was intact on both right and left.
Yeah, here can you tell me other reflexes? Have you looked for other reflexes other than your classical biceps, triceps, and supinator? Did you look for pectoral jerk? Did you look for finger flexion reflex? Did you look for trapezius reflex? So at least these three additional reflexes you can write in your UG paper as well. Okay. So you can look for the pectoral jerk, you can look for the trapezius jerk in the back, as well as the finger flexion reflex. Okay. So finger flexion is C8T1, pectoral becomes around again C5C6, and trapezius becomes around C3C4. Okay. So all these three reflexes are very important for us. Okay. So they will help us to localize the lesion in case of a chronic UMN disease. Okay. If you have a cervical cord disease, you have to localize what level the disease is coming, C3 level or C4 level or C5 level or C6 level. In such conditions, you have to have all these levels so that we will be able to tell the examiner what exactly is the level of the disease. Okay. In a stroke patient, it may not be as important for you, But in the case of other chronic disorders, probably these things are important for us. Okay, so we can tell the exact level of cervical cord lesion. We call it as high cord lesion. Okay, so what exactly is the level and where exactly is the reflex loss or the reflex exaggeration? Remember, at the level, reflex is lost. Below the level, reflex is exaggerated. It applies to majority of the neurological disorders. Okay, especially when you are dealing with the case of myelopathy. It may not be important for stroke, but myelopathy, it is important. Okay, yeah, go ahead.
Sensory system is intact on both right and left.
Yeah, here it should be very careful regarding sensory. I have already told. So don't comment on cortical sensations when primary sensations are not correct. They are lost. Okay. And cortical sensations also, you should be very careful. Is it right hemispheric stroke or left hemispheric stroke? Okay. So I think you heard about sensory inattention, sensory neglect, and denial and other things. Okay, right? So these are basically spectrum of severity. Okay. Initially, it will be only inattention, then becomes neglect, then becomes denial. A severe right hemispheric stroke, let us say right parietal lobe is entirely affected. Patient may not notice that his left body is existing, okay? And he may actually deny that he has got a disease, okay? And in very early stages, he may have only inattention. Inattention is basically when you have to do a simultaneous sensory examination on right and left side. Then only we'll be able to make out that there is a left side impairment, okay? In the next stage, he may neglect it, okay? He may tell there is nothing wrong with me, okay? In a very severe form, they may totally deny and they may totally disagree with you that he has got a disease, okay? So sensory pattern of involvement is very much varied and it can actually become a spectrum of involvement as a disease progress or the disease severity increases, okay? So I think cortical sensations you are aware of, right? Asteriognosis, other things, two-point discrimination, localization, finger. So all these things should be known to you. Examiners can ask you at any point of time. So these things should be committed only when the primary modalities of sensations are intact. That is very important. Okay. If your primary modalities are gone, then there is no point in talking about the cortical sensations. Okay. And I think the tracts you should be knowing, as at least as undergraduate, you should know the sensory tracts, descending tracts, as well as ascending tracts, and where do they cross, how do they cross. So these things, it becomes too much if I keep telling. So these things are very basic for us. And the decussations and the localizations are important for us. Okay. Accordingly, we can tell where is the level of the lesion. Okay. Yeah. Go ahead.
Cerebellar functions were normal. The gate seen was a circumduction gate.
Yeah. See, cerebellar functions should not. Can you comment on the right side here on cerebellar functions?
No.
Yeah. So what is the definition of ataxia?
Definition, I'm not sure.
You can tell the understanding of it. Ataxia is lack of taxis. There is lack of order. Okay. So lack of order, you have to comment only when the primary things are intact. Okay. So we don't know if motor power is profoundly affected, we cannot comment on ataxia. Okay. So at least motor power should be more than against gravity to comment on ataxia. Otherwise, we cannot comment on ataxia. So if motor power is 2/5, 1/5, then because of the profound motor weakness, obviously incoordination is not possible at all. The coordination is not possible at all. So if patient is not able to lift the hand itself, how can he do a finger nose coordination test? It's not possible, right? That is why you shouldn't comment on ataxia when there is profound motor weakness. Okay, so let us reserve it. You can comment on nystagmus if it is obeying the command. You can comment on speech. That is also possible. Okay, other than that, we cannot comment on many of the other things. Okay, I think you know the basics of cerebellar function examination, right? So everything is about coordination. Speech scanning is lack of coordination of speech muscles. Staccato is again frontopontine control is affected. Then your decidococcus is again rapid alternating, coordination is affected. Okay. Rebound is basically the check mechanism is basically lost. Okay. What happens to the tone in case of cerebellar disease? Tone
is hypotonia.
Hypotonia, yeah. Although this is a little paradoxical in cerebellar disease. I think you would have read, right? So decreased fusimotor response will cause hypotonia in a cerebellar disease, despite having cerebellum having a negative response on the tone. Okay. These are the things to be remembered. So this is, you know, multifactorial. Basically, tone control is very much dynamic. So a lot of things are actually important to maintain the tone, right? So that is the reason. Okay. Yeah. Go ahead.
There were no signs of meningeal irritation. Examination of skull and spine is normal. Auscultation of neck showed no carotid bruit.
Yeah. See, meningeal irritation, I think we have already described, because, you know, meningeal irritation, you have thought about the infective causes causing a lot of, you know, meningitis and vasculitic infarcts. That is the reason why you have talked about it. Good. Skull and spine, did you think anything? Did you ask for any specific reason? Mm-hmm. Any abnormal shape of skull and stroke? Is it possible? It is probably important in certain genetic disorders. It may be too much for you. Certain inherited, you know, disorders, in some certain IEMs, certain mucopolysaccharidosis, having those things can have, some of them can have high propensity for stroke. Okay. For example, Down syndrome patients may have hypothyroidism, may have high propensity for stroke. Okay. So it is basically about the etiology of the disease or a systemic disease. If you're talking about a systemic disease producing stroke, then these things, GP, general physical examination findings, are important for us. Okay. So many of the neurocutaneous syndromes may having high propensity for stroke. some of the vascularity syndromes having propensity for the stroke. So those things, the skeletal span becomes more important. Okay, so it is not for anything else. It is, we are dealing with the overall picture, the holistic picture to talk about the skeletal span. Okay, so auscultation, have you looked into anything specific?
The carotid bruit.
Yeah, bruit. Can you tell me where did you look for? What did you find? When is it absent? When is it present?
Only when the carotid is narrowed between 30% to 70%,
okay,
will you hear
moderate stenosis. Okay, yeah. So complete stenosis, it will be absent. Very early stenosis, it will be absent. Did you look for any suboccipital area? Anything you have looked for? Suboccipital triangle? Any other bruits you look for?
Notable.
Yeah, old examiners are fond of all this, you know, posterior circulation bruits. Okay, it may not be clinically that well made out for many of us, but the generation of exams also you should consider. Sometimes, you know, you should think of, you know, other bruits as well. Renal artery bruits, vertebral artery bruits, carotid artery bruits. So they may not be, you know, very significant in this modern era. But however, for our clinical point of view, you should be careful about all these things. Okay, yeah, go ahead.
Other system examination was normal. Cardiovascular S1, S2 heard, no murmurs, no carotid bruits heard.
Yeah, yeah.
Respiratory system showed normal vesicular breath sounds with no added sounds present. Abdominal examination was normal, where abdomen was soft and non-tender with no organomegaly.
Suppose this patient had got a lot of crepitus in the lung. Okay, he has got, you know, a lot of crepitations, basal crepitations. Can you tell me what are the possibilities, just by common sense?
Pulmonary edema.
Yeah, edema can happen in what are the conditions in this case of stroke? Okay. Either there is a hypertension related LV failure causing pulmonary edema, or it could be a neurogenic pulmonary edema. Okay, there's a condition called neurogenic pulmonary edema, especially more severe, commonly seen in subarachnoid hemorrhage and head injuries. Okay, so there they can also have crepitations. And Ritvik is telling, yeah, good, aspirations. So stroke patients are known to aspirate, and aspiration can also cause crepitations. Okay, that is why a respiratory system is important for us. Okay, so aspiration is one. Remember this, in a stroke patient, if mortality happens in our wards, it's most likely due to chest infection than anything else. Okay, so aspiration is one of the important causes. They hurriedly feed them. They feed them in supine position. Whenever you go to ward, whenever you see a patient of stroke in supine position being fed by the attenders, you should always warn and stop them. Okay, we have seen and lost patients because of this. Okay, so stroke per se doesn't kill in ward. Many of the times it is lung infections, the aspirations. Okay, so always make sure you give a good chest physiotherapy for a stroke patient. Okay, because they are immobile, the base of the lung is collapsed, and they are likely to pull up the secretions and aspirate. Okay, this is very important. Okay, so as an MBBS student, it is not just we are going to learn the neurology or medicine, we also try to address the common things. Okay, in what? Okay, that is why these things are important for us. Okay, abdominal examination, does it make any sense for us in a stroke patient?
Mm-hmm.
If there is aneurysm of aorta, if there is something in the pulsating abdomen, okay, if there is a dissection, okay, or if there is any organomegaly in the case of systemic disease, if there is hepatosplenomegaly, okay, these are the things which is important for us. Okay, that is why abdominal examination is also important. It's not about for a sake of completion we are writing. So this is about involving all the other organs, and are we dealing with the involvement of a single disease presenting in different forms? Okay, yeah, go ahead.
Provisional diagnosis. Clinical diagnosis shows hemiparesis of right upper and lower limb and neuronal shock with right-sided upper motor neuron type of facial palsy and Broca's aphasia. Anatomical is left middle cerebral artery territory, and etiology I thought was probably because of hypertension and diabetes mellitus.
Yeah, what you written is fine, but you have to put in under four headings. What are the neurodeficits? Okay, what are the structures involved? What is the pathology? What is the etiology? These are the four things. Okay, any neurology case, if you take, you put in under these four headings, it becomes easier for you. You take transverse myelitis, you take GB syndrome, you take motor neuron disease, anything. Okay, so neurodeficit is what the patient is actually suffering from. Okay, then comes the structures involved. What are the structures you probably thinking the thing they are involved? Okay, third thing would be pathology. Is it an infective pathology? Is it an inflammatory pathology? Is it a demyelinating pathology? Is it a vascular pathology? Okay, then comes etiology. Etiology is finally what is the final diagnosis. Is it a multiple sclerosis? Is it motor neuron disease? Okay, that is how it is. Okay, so in this case, probably it is very much clear cut. There is not much of DDs in this particular case. It's a clear cut case of acute onset, sudden onset neurological deficit in the form of right hemiparesis with basical involvement of left hemisphere, that is basically lateralization, and then comes a localization, that is probably in the MCA territory area, because he has got involvement of speech, involvement of facial nerve, as well as involvement of right upper and lower limb. Okay, that is slightly more in the right upper limb considering the the depth distribution of the nerve fibers. Okay, we know the topographic localization, right? How the distribution of upper hand area and leg area as well as the speech area. Okay, so accordingly, we should, that the mental picture, the diagram, we should have always in your mind so that we can tell what is the exact area that is being involved. Let us say this patient has got only facio-brachial weakness. Let us say his lower limb is normal. Can you think of something, Mahima? Facio-brachial weakness. Face and upper limb only involved.
Anterior cerebral artery involvement.
Yeah, recurrent artery of Huebner. Okay, that is what you should be thinking about. Okay, so our branch called recurrent artery of Huebner probably will cause only facio-brachial weakness. Even in the MCA, there is a differential involvement can also have only facio-brachial weakness because MCA is predominantly upper limb and AC is predominantly lower limb. Okay, that is how it is. Okay, so the branch is also important. Okay, right, that is how you should think about it. Okay, suppose this patient has got, see here, how do you tell? You have anything else to tell? You have a summary or something?
No, sir.
Yeah, fine, no issues. Yeah. So let us say, how do you tell it? Can it be a spinal stroke? Why to think of a cortical stroke? Can it be a spinal stroke? Can spinal cord disease produce stroke?
It can, anterior spinal artery.
Yeah, it can produce stroke, but what is the odd point here? Can it be a spinal stroke in this case?
Aphasia wouldn't have.
Aphasia is against, then number one. Number two, facial palsy. Can you get facial palsy? No, so facial palsy is against, okay? And in the case of antispinal artery infarction, it will be dissociated sensory loss, right? So you'll have involvement of sparing of dorsal column. Posteriorly, things will be spared, okay? Anteriorly, things will be involved. And there will be involvement of bladder, okay? And one side, it is very, very unusual. Generally, it will be both sides, okay? That is one thing, okay? Do you think it is a cortical stroke or a subcortical stroke?
It can't be cortical. There's no history of seizures.
He has aphasia, right?
Subcortical would have been pure motor.
Yeah. So moment aphasia comes, there are two things. Okay. See, for a UG level, should I tell? So in the case of aphasia, aphasia can be cortical. Sometimes it can be subcortical. We call it a subcortical aphasia. Okay. So remember this entity. If at all somebody asks you or somebody to defend yourself, you can use this. So in subcortical aphasia, we have an anterior aphasia as well as a posterior aphasia, similar to whatever you have in a cortical aphasia. Okay. Thalamic aphasia is called a posterior aphasia and striatocapsular is called an anterior aphasia. Okay. Even in the involvement of striatum and capsule, striatocapsular, you can still have an aphasia. We call it as anterior aphasia. It is similar to Broca's aphasia. There will be impairment of grammar, there will be impairment of expression, and there will be the vocabulary will be poor. Okay. Whereas in a posterior aphasia, generally, it will be more of comprehension will be intact and there will be lot of, you know, verbal output is generally not impaired. Okay. So what happens is, in a case of stroke, aphasia alone sometimes will not tell us, is it cortical or subcortical? If there is a lot of edema, then the patient can have aphasia. Okay. So the deficit may not be due to the structure involved per se. It may be due to two things. It may be arterial sharing between two sides, or it may be involvement of the edema in the two different areas. Okay. So if edema is extending or encroaching, then we can have a deficit which is not primary to the primary disease. Understood, no? That is the reason why it can happen. Okay. So if there's a dense hemiplegia, then you think of an internal capsular lesion. If hemiplegia is not that dense, then you think of a cortical lesion. In a patient who has got an altered sensorium with that dense hemiplegia, you think of a large cortical lesion. Okay. When your patient is a conscious patient, you has got a very dense hemiplegia, then you think of a small lesion in a very critical area of the brain, that is internal capsule. Okay. Because the fibers all are merged together in such an extent, a small lesion will produce a large deficit. Okay. In a large area to produce a large deficit, lesion has to be large. In a small lesion has to produce a large deficit means fibers has to be aggregated. That is the idea behind this. Okay. That is how. Can you tell me briefly about internal capsule? Because it is very relevant for us. Have you read about internal capsule, the distribution of fibers?
Anterior limb, genu, okay. And posterior limb.
Excellent.
The posterior limb, the anterior part is mostly the corticospinal tract.
Excellent.
Whereas the posterior limb has thalamic radiation.
Very good. Excellent.
The genu is the corticobulbar.
Excellent.
Corticobulbar. And the anterior is mostly sensory fibers.
Yeah, corticus is basically frontopontan fibers. Okay, so this is important thought. And we have a retro lentiform as well as a sublentiform part. I think you know about it, right? Auditory radiation as well as optic radiations. Can you tell briefly the blood supply of it? Because we're running short of time.
Yes, sir. The anterior, each limb and the genu is divided into upper
superior
and lower.
Inferior. Excellent.
And the upper part of all the three, that is the anterior limb, the genu, and the posterior limb, is by the lenticular striate branches.
Okay.
The anterior, the lower part of the anterior limb is by Huebner's artery. And the genu and posterior limb can be from branches of the internal carotid directly.
It is basically middle cerebral artery as well as anterocerebral artery. You can divide like that. Anterior part is from the anterocerebral artery and middle part is from the middle cerebral artery. Okay. And the upper part is in together is by the middle cerebral artery. That is penetrating branches. We call it as lenticulostriate artery. What is another name for lenticulostriate artery?
Sort
of Charcot's artery of cerebral hemorrhage. Okay, that's very important. Okay, Charcot's artery of cerebral hemorrhage. Okay, so that is important artery to cause, you know, bleed in the brain whenever there is hypertensive crisis. Okay, so what happens in case of hypertension is the subcortical areas, their hydrostatic pressure is much higher. There is a difference in the innervation, the autonomic control. Okay, because of that they are likely to bleed. Okay, so this is a very important artery which bleeds. We call it as Charcot's artery of cerebral hemorrhage. Okay, yeah. So how do you manage this patient? So I think the diagnosis is clear. So stroke mimickers we have discussed, differential diagnosis we have discussed. Okay, let us go with the brief management of this patient at the undergraduate level. Yeah.
Yes, sir. The first, when the patient comes to you, the first thing is to take a CT to make sure it's not a hemorrhagic stroke.
Yeah, very good.
But ischemic stroke will not present on this CT acutely.
Very early, okay.
So for that, we can take a diffusion-weighted MRI, which will show an infarct, which will show an hyperintensity.
Excellent.
And then the perfusion-weighted MRI will show you the presence of a penumbra.
Yeah, yeah. I'll just brief it out for you. See, presence of MRI, stroke in MRI is not mandatory till it is an ischemic stroke, okay? So very early, as I discussed earlier, very early MRI can be normal, very early CT can be normal, okay? So here CT is just to rule out the bleed too, because we are more worried about thrombolysis, okay? So present focus is all about thrombolysis, okay? We have chemical thrombolysis, we have mechanical thrombolysis, okay? That is what is the idea behind. So because stroke is to be called as brain attack, because people know about heart attack, they run to cardiologist because they have a heart attack, because heart cries in pain. Unfortunately, brain doesn't cry in pain. Because patient doesn't have pain, they tend to neglect it. Okay, so most of the times stroke gets delayed, diagnosis gets delayed, and patient comes with a lot of deficits. Okay, because the morbidity part patient suffers, the breadwinner suffers is very much large. Okay, that is why this is very important. You have to push the public regarding the importance of recoining the term as brain attack, because, you know, patient at least should be aware of this particular thing. So within 4.5 hours, we give thrombolytic agents. I don't want to go into the details of management. So we have antiprase, we have tenecteprase, and with the other drugs. Okay. So first we rule out the bleed. We see if there is any, you know, we look into the collaterals. Okay. So remember, in stroke, it is about collaterals. If collaterals are good, then the outcome is better. See, if main road is blocked, we go by bypass road, right? So bypass road should be proper. Okay. Bypass road is also blocked, then we have a huge mess. Okay. So it is about the collaterals and it's about the penumbra. So we have to save the penumbra. Saving penumbra is basically saving the time. Okay. So whatever the around the stroke, that area you have to save. That is what is entertaining all of the stroke therapies. Okay. So as a resident, as an MBBS resident, you should know that in a case of ischemic stroke, high dose statins are very important and thrombolysing is very important. Okay. If you're not thrombolysing, if patient has crossed the window period within 24 hours, we still have an opportunity for mechanical thrombectomy. And those, some patients, we also do something called bridging thrombolysis. Okay. We give chemical thrombolysis followed by mechanical thrombolysis. Okay. So as a resident, at least this much you should know, that we know therapies of stroke are much more advanced now and we can have a lot of things. Okay. So this is important thing. Okay. So somebody else is asking about TIA and MRA negative stroke. It is a very good question. So TIA is basically a clinical diagnosis. In TIA, we have MRA negative TIA as well as MRA positive TIAs. Okay. So TIA is the tissue-based TIA definition is different. The clinical TIA definition is different. Okay. So by definition, the 24 hours, whatever the thing concept we used to use earlier, generally it will not last for such a long time. Generally within 5 to 10 minutes, things will start recovering in a case of TIA. If it is going for much more longer period of time, you have to probably investigate more. Okay. And MRA negative TIA and MRA positive TIA is basically based on the tissue-based definitions. So sometimes TIA may have a clinical, the patient may be having TIA, and radiologically there may be infarct. Okay. Still, within that window period, then we still call it as clinical TIAs. Okay. So this is very important, because TIA is very important, because patients can in future may have a high risk of stroke. Okay. We have a lot of scoring systems for that to prognosticate them and to go ahead. Okay. This is about the brief management of this particular patient. So if he has come within the window, things will be different. If window is closed, then you have to open other doors. Okay. Open other doors of other therapies. Okay. And very important thing is about rehabilitation. Okay. So stroke rehabilitation is very much neglected in our country, unfortunately. And, you know, but stroke rehabilitation is very, very important. A lot of things are coming up in modern era. We call functional neurostimulation. We have a functional electrical stimulation, and we can, you know, make the patient walk with a lot of rehabilitative maneuvers. So as far as possible, you have to try to avoid patient going into the stage of rehabilitation, because, you know, if functional disability is addressed early, we can avoid the patient going into that stage. Okay. So this is about the inclusive management of this particular patient. Okay. Anything else you want to ask?
So the role of aspirin and clopidogrel.
Yeah, see, if loading dose of the stroke management, loading dose of drugs, that is around 325 mg of aspirin and around 300 mg of clopidogrel with high intensity statin, around 80 mg of atorvastatin we give when when the patient is out of the window and patient is not eligible candidate for thrombolysis. Okay, otherwise we generally wait for 24 hours for the antiplatelet to start in. Okay, and we give dual antiplatelets for a stroke of NHS score of less than 4. Okay, for a period of 3 months. Generally for a period of 3 months. The trials we call it as chance and point trials. A lot of clinical trials which have shown that it is dual antiplatelet therapy is beneficial for a period of first 3 months. Then we switch into single therapy. Okay. And if patient has got if patient has got atrial fibrillation, then we think of anticoagulation. Anticoagulation also, we have got a lot of rule. We have a rule of 3, 6, 9, and 12. Okay. And 12 and 15. So what we do is we look into the severity of stroke. If stroke is minor, then we start the anticoagulation early. If stroke is very large, then we wait for a period of up to 2 weeks to start anticoagulation, because the benefit of starting an anticoagulation in the case of stroke is much, much less than the risk of bleed. Okay. That is why we generally wait for generally for 2 weeks to start anticoagulation in the case of large stroke. Okay. So we generally the per se heparin doesn't have much role in strokes except for certain special conditions like an embolic phenomenon. Otherwise, we generally stick with antiplatelets. Okay. And statin should be a high intensity statin, and addressing the risk factor is very, very important. Okay. Here I would be more interested in finding out the vascular imaging. Does he have any stenosis in the carotids? Does he have any intracranial stenosis? Does he have any other systemic disorders having stroke? Because he has a recent hypertension, recent diabetes, no smoking, no alcohol. Okay. Here I'll be much more aggressive in evaluating the cause. Does he have any hyperhomocysteinemia? Does he have any polycythemia? So all these things we have to address. Okay. Simple CBC, what you send in stroke, is very crucial for us. Okay. The peripheral smear is crucial for us. The blood counts are crucial for us. The hemoglobin is crucial for us. Anemia can also cause stroke. Polycythemia can also cause stroke. Okay. So every ink you write from your pen as an investigation in the case of stroke makes a difference for our management. Okay. Yeah. Anything else, Mahima?
No, sir.
Yeah, fine. I think that made sense. Probably open the chat box as well. So yeah, ABCD score somebody has written. That is important for prognostication. Yeah, good. Yeah, I think other things have been addressed. So if there is anything, you can also contact me. Sickle cell we have addressed. Okay. Irregular respiration indicates rhesus. That's a good thing. Thinking by Tejas feeling good. Yeah, BP I think have addressed. Phrenic nerve injury and stroke. Yes, that is a good point. So phrenic nerve is, we have the root value, right? C3, C4. It can also cause diaphragmatic failure. Parkinson's disease, we don't write in this. Somebody's asking whether in PD, Parkinson's disease, should we write in all four sections? Yes. See, all these things are correct. Neurodeficits, you have to write in Parkinson's disease, and even in extrapyramidal disease, like a Wilson's disease or a Parkinson's disease, when you write a diagnosis, you have to write in all four headings. And the pathology becomes degenerative in all these conditions. Okay. Yeah. I'll just go through the chat box. TIS, we have discussed. Dual antiplatelet therapy also, I have addressed. Yeah. I think that is it in the chat box. So good, Mahima, you've done a wonderful presentation. I think I addressed what are the basic things that is required. Okay. So I try to keep as basic as possible for the MBBS level. Heartily congratulate you for your wonderful presentation. Use this in your clinical practice. Okay. And every patient you see,
no doubts on YouTube as well.
Sure. Yeah. Use this, whatever the small bits that I have told in your clinical practice, so that we can make a better outcome in patient's life. Okay. That is the final goal of all of us. Okay. Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Any concluding remarks?
Yeah, from me or from Mahima?
Sir, from you, sir.
Yeah. See, White Army, the whatever the YouTube channel we are having and whatever we are doing is an excellent job. It is a beautiful platform where all the consultants, teachers can interact with the students. And I'm extremely grateful to Kishan for his for this wonderful opportunity. I know Kishan since a long time. So it is a wonderful opportunity. I'm really thankful for the entire management of this online platform. And I hope, this small bits of teaching makes a difference in our patient's life as well as our student's life, because the motivation that is lacking in our recent teachings. So we have to motivate students, because everybody has got an ability and everybody has got, we are all like Hanumans. We don't know our ability most of the times. We think we are incapable of doing a lot of things, but we are capable of doing a lot of things. Okay. We should know that we have ability so that we can bring a difference in patient's life. Whenever you see a patient, don't think only of the examination point of view. Think how we can make a difference in their lives. Every sign you ask, every sign you examine, every history you ask, okay? Think, can you make a difference with those particular lines? Okay, that's how you should approach every case. So Whenever you take a negative history, each negative history should have a positive intent in it, okay? So that we can make a difference in their lives, okay? That is how you should approach a patient. And I wish all of them all the best. And anything in the future, I wish to, you know, to join this platform again for some other teaching schedule in the future, okay? Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir, for taking your time to be with us today. We are very grateful to have gotten this opportunity to learn from you.
Sure.
Looking forward to more such sessions, sir.
Sure. Thank you so much. Bye.
Thank you, Mahima, for your well-prepared presentation. We all got to learn a lot from you today. Thank you, audience, for your active participation. Also, for further doubts, you can check our YouTube channel.